Good morning, students. Greetings for the day. In the last chapter, we considered the design of IIR digital filters. For such filters, it was necessary that to ensure whether the derived transfer function h of z is stable or not. On the other hand, in this chapter, we are going to study about the FIR digital filter design, where the stability is not a design issue as the transfer function is a polynomial in Z inverse and is thus always guaranteed to be stable. In this chapter, we consider the FIR digital filter design problems. Unlike the IIR digital filters, it is always possible to design FIR filters which are stable with exact linear phase. First of all, we will study the approach for the design of FIR digital filters with linear phases. In this particular presentation, I would like to start with the introduction to FIR filters. As we know, all the digital systems or the filters are frequency selective devices. In order to say all, that is nothing but whenever we consider a LTI system, it always performs filtering among the various components of the input. As we know that the relation between the output, input and the impulse response of an LTI system is given as y of e power j omega is equal to h of e power j omega into x of e power j omega whenever we consider the relation in terms of Fourier transforms. The nature of this filtering action is determined by the frequency characteristics or the frequency response characteristics h of e power j omega, which in turn depends upon the choice of the system parameters, that is the coefficients that what we consider the AKs and the BKs in the difference equation which is governed by the system. Thus, by proper selection of the coefficients, we can design frequency selective filters that pass signals with frequency components in some bands, while they attenuate signals that contain frequency components in other frequency bands. In general, the specification of a digital filter will be desired frequency response. The LTI system modifies the input spectrum x of e power j omega according to its frequency response h of e power j omega to yield an output signal with the spectrum y of e power j omega. In a sense, h of e power j omega acts as a weighing function or a spectral shaping function for the different frequency components in the input signal. When viewed in this context, LTI system can be considered to be a frequency shaping filter, even though it may not completely block or all frequency components. Consequently, I use this term LTI system and filter as synonymous and are often used interchangeably. So now, coming to the definition of FIR filters, as I have said, in general, the specification of a digital filter will be the desired frequency response. Let us consider it to be HD of e power j omega. The desired impulse response HD of n of that digital filter can be taken by taking the inverse Fourier transform of h d of e power j, capital H d of e power j omega. Now h d of n will be an infinite duration discrete time signal defined for all values of n in the range minus infinity to plus infinity. Since h d of n is an infinite duration signal, the transfer function obtained from h d of n will be having infinite terms, which cannot be realized or implemented in a digital system. Therefore, finite number of samples of h d of n are selected to form the impulse response h of n of the filter. The transfer function that's obtained by taking z transform of finite sample impulse response h of n, or the filters designed by using finite samples of impulse responses, are called as FIR filters, the finite impulse response filters. Since we have already studied about IIR filters, let us gather some points so that we can better choose between these FIR and IIR filters based upon our requirements. The choice between FIR and IIR filters largely depends upon the relative advantages of the two filter types, that is IIR and FIR filters. First one, the FIR filters can have an exact linear phase response, that is no phase distortion is introduced into the signal by the filter. The phase responses of IIR filters are always nonlinear, especially at band edges. And the second advantage that we see with respect to FIR filters is FIR filters can be realized recursively as well as non-recursively. However, FIR filters, when realized non-recursively, they are always stable. But however, in the case of IIR filters, the stability of those filters cannot always be guaranteed. And similarly, the effect of using a limited number of bits to implement filters such as round off noise and coefficient quantization errors are much less severe in FIR filters when compared to IIR filters. Similarly, now since we have seen certain advantages with respect to FIR filters, we will also discuss some of their disadvantages. FIR filters requires more coefficients for sharp cutoff filters than IIR filters. Thus, for any given amplitude response specifications, more processing time and storage will be required for FIR implementations. On the other hand, analog filter can be readily transformed into equivalent IIR digital filters meeting similar specifications. We have seen this already in the case of IIR filters. But this is not always possible with FIR filters, as they have no analog counterparts. However, with FIR filters, it is easier to synthesize FIR filters of arbitrary frequency responses. In general, FIR filters is algebraically more difficult to synthesize if CAD support is not available. These are some of those points that we need to look upon whenever we are choosing between FIR and IIR filters. Based upon these points, I say that if you would like to design or choose IIR filter design, only use this IARs when only your important requirements are sharp cutoff filters and high throughput, as IAR filters, especially those using elliptical characteristics, will give us fewer coefficients when compared to this FIR filter designs. And always use FIR filter designs if the number of filter coefficients is not too large, and in particular if little or no phase is your requirements. And now we shall see the ideal frequency responses of some of those filters. We generally know about the filters which are classified according to their frequency response characteristics. The ideal frequency responses of the four major ideal filters are given below. The first one represents the frequency response of a ideal low pass filter, which has its cutoff frequency omega c. And similarly, in the second figure, we show the ideal frequency response of high pass filter, and similarly with respect to the band pass filters and band stop filters. All these ideal filters are non-causal, and hence they are physically unrealizable for real-time signal processing applications. The causality implies that the frequency response characteristics of the filters cannot be zero except at a finite set of points in frequency. In addition, h of e power j omega cannot have an infinitely sharp cutoff from pass band to stop band, that is, h of e power j omega cannot drop from unity to zero abruptly. That is, in practice, it is not necessary, or their their magnitude responses cannot be equal to a constant over a band of frequencies. That is, we may allow a small amount of ripple in the stop band, which is tolerable. And similarly, a small amount of ripple in the pass band is also usually tolerable. The transition of the frequency response from pass band to stop band defines the transition band or the transition region of the filter. With this short introduction, I would like to now discuss about the FIR filters and understand the key characteristics of them. As I have said already, the basic FIR filters is generally characterized by the following two equations. As we know, the impulse response in this case is finite from 0 to n minus 1. Therefore, if we consider the impulse response is finite from 0 to n minus 1, then the response of this filter, or the y of n, the output of the filter, can be governed by this equation, as we know that the relation between the input and the impulse response is given out of this digital convolution. That is, sigma k is equal to 0 to n minus 1 h of k into x of n minus k. This is considered to be the difference equation of FIR filters. And similarly, we can always represent the transfer function of the FIR filters in terms of h of z by considering the impulse response h of k, which is finite in nature. And therefore, h of z, the transfer function of the system, is given as sigma k is equal to 0 to n minus 1 h of k into z power minus k, based upon the definition of the z transform, where here the h of k represents the impulse response coefficients for k is equal to 0, 1, so on until n minus 1, and h of z is called as a transfer function. Now the another key characteristic of FIR filters is it can have an exact linear phase responses. What does this imply is, let us consider when a signal is passed through a filter. As we know that whenever it is passed through a filter, it is modified in its amplitude or end or in phase. The nature and extent of this modification depends upon the amplitude and phase characteristics of the filter. If we consider a signal that consists of several frequency components, I now define two terms known as the phase delay and the group delay. The phase delay of the filter is the amount of time delay that each frequency component of the signal suffers when it is going through that filter. Similarly, the group delay is the average time delay that the composite signal suffers at each particular frequency. This is a general definition of phase delay and group delay. I use these terms in order to explain the exact linear phase response of this FIR filters. Mathematically, the phase delay can also be defined as the negative of the phase angle divided by the frequency, whereas the group delay is the negative of the derivative of the phase with respect to the frequency. That is, I represent them with TP and TG, where TP represents the phase delay and TG represents the group delay. Based upon this mathematical definitions, they are represented as minus of theta of omega by omega, where theta of omega represents the phase angle divided by that frequency. And similarly, TG represents the derivative or the change in the phase angle with respect to each particular omega. Generally, a filter with non-linear phase characteristics will cause a phase distortion in the signal that passes through it. This is because the frequency components in the signal will each be delayed by an amount which is not proportional to frequency. Thereby, it alters the harmonic relationship. Such a distortion is undesirable, and this can be avoided by using filters with linear phase characteristics. Okay, and this is the advantage of the FIR filters, so that the frequency components in the signals will not be delayed. So now we shall understand the linear phase of this FIR filters by a small derivation. Let us consider the transfer function of a FIR causal filter, which is given as h of z is equal to sigma k is equal to 0 to n minus 1 h of k into z power minus k, or this can also be represented in terms of n. And I write it as h of z is equal to sigma n is equal to 0 to n minus 1 h of n into z power minus n. So now, representing the Fourier transform of the impulse response, replacing z with e power j omega, we get it as h of e power j omega is equal to sigma n is equal to 0 to n minus 1 h of n into e power minus j omega n, which is periodic in frequency with a period of 2 pi. As we know this, the Fourier transform h of e power j omega can be represented with respect to its magnitude responses and the phase responses, and is given as plus or minus of magnitude of h of e power j omega into e power j theta of omega, where this represents a magnitude response and theta of omega represents a phase response of the filter. As we know, the phase delay and the group delay are defined as Tp is equal to minus theta of omega by omega and Tg is equal to minus d theta of omega by d omega. Let us now define the FIR filters, which has linear phase as theta of omega is equal to minus alpha omega, where omega is between minus pi to pi, where alpha is a constant phase delay in samples. Now, as theta of omega is equal to minus alpha omega, substituting this theta of omega in the definitions of Tp and Tg, we will be able to see that the Tp, the phase delay, is equal to minus alpha omega by omega, which is simply equal to alpha. Similarly, in the case of Tg also, we will be able to see that whenever we substitute theta of omega with alpha, this will be yielding us a value of alpha itself. Therefore, now we have this Tp as well as Tg is equal to alpha, which means that alpha is independent of frequency. As we know that the Fourier transform of h of e power j omega can be equated with respect to its magnitude response and phase responses. So now I write two equations based upon this relation. The magnitude response, this can be e power minus j omega n, can be represented with respect to Euler's identity as cos omega n minus j sin omega n, and equating the real and imaginary parts on both the terms, I have sigma n is equal to 0 to n minus 1 h of n into cos omega n is equal to plus or minus h of e power j omega into cos of theta of omega, where this e power j theta of omega is also expanded with respect to Euler's identity. Equating the real parts and imaginary parts, I have these two equations, and taking the ratio of these two equations, I now have a equation something like sigma n is equal to 0 to n minus 1 h of n sin omega n by sigma n is equal to 0 to n minus 1 h of n cos omega n. And on the right hand side, we have it as sin alpha omega by cos alpha omega, where theta of omega is substituted with minus alpha omega. And sin theta of omega can be written as minus sin alpha omega. However, this negative sign is cancelled on both sides, whereas cos theta of omega is replaced with cos of minus alpha omega. And since cos of minus theta is equal to cos theta, we have this cos alpha omega. After simplifying, we have, so just by cross multiplying and simplifying this expression, we have sigma n is equal to 0 to n minus 1 h of n into sin of alpha minus n into omega is equal to 0. This equation will be zero only when this h of n is equal to h of n minus 1 minus n, and alpha is equal to, and this particular alpha is equal to n minus 1 by 2. This particular condition can be easily shown, as we know that h of n into sine of alpha minus n omega can be substituted with sine of n minus 1 by 2 minus n into omega, and thereby solving, you will be always equal to, just by substituting these expressions, these values in here, you will be able to see that this expression will be equal to 0. Therefore, we can say that FIR filters will have this constant phase and group delays when the impulse response is symmetrical. Since this relation will say that the impulse response is symmetrical about alpha is equal to n minus 1 by 2. I would like to show that this impulse response is satisfying this above conditions for odd and even values of n as shown in these figures. Let us consider where the sequence has some 7 samples, the impulse response has some 7 samples, where now the center of symmetry alpha is equal to n minus 1 by 2 lies at 3, because 7 minus 1 by 2 which becomes 6 by 2 which is equal to 3 in this case. When n is equal to 7, the center of symmetry of the sequence occurs at the third sample, and therefore you will be able to see that the impulse response is symmetrical with respect to this alpha, which is equal to n minus 1 by 2. And similarly, whenever n is even with a value of 6, let us consider for n is equal to 6, then the center of the symmetry now lies at 2.5 samples. However, this sample is not present here, since the samples are with respect to 0, 1, 2, 3, 5, integer multiples, integer values. So, however, the center of symmetry lies here in this case whenever n is even, and this is also symmetric with respect to this alpha is equal to n minus 1 by 2. Therefore, now we can clearly say that FIR filters will be having a constant phase and group delays when only the impulse response is symmetrical about alpha is equal to n minus 1 by 2. And if we require only a constant group delay but not a constant phase delay, then we can always take theta of omega as beta minus alpha omega. As in the earlier case, we have assumed that theta of omega is equal to minus alpha omega. Here in this case, now I consider theta of omega is equal to beta minus alpha omega. Now, we have the following expressions based upon this theta of omega, where I have substituted theta of omega with beta minus alpha omega. And similarly, the frequency responses are now represented in terms of their magnitude and phase responses, and that phase response theta of omega is now substituted with beta minus alpha omega. And whenever once again we expand this h of omega e power j omega with respect to its Fourier transform relations and represent it in terms of the real parts and imaginary parts by representing these exponents in terms of Euler identities, once again I have two equations, sigma n is equal to 0 to n minus 1, h of n cos omega n, and this e power j beta of minus omega, beta minus alpha omega will have a real term which is equal to cos of beta minus alpha omega multiplied with this magnitude of h of e power j omega. Equating these two terms and considering the ratio of these two equations, I have the equation which is represented as minus of sigma n is equal to 0 to n minus 1 h of n sin omega n by sigma n is equal to 0 to n minus 1 h of n cos omega n equal to sin of beta minus alpha omega by cos of beta minus alpha omega. Rearranging those terms in the above equations, we can obtain a relation such that sigma n is equal to 0 to n minus 1 h of n sin of beta minus alpha minus n into omega is equal to 0. If beta is equal to pi by 2, this can be written as in terms of this cos omega relationships, where it can be simply represented as sigma n is equal to 0 to n minus 1 h of n cos of alpha minus n into omega, which is equal to 0. This equation will only be satisfied whenever we consider h of n is equal to minus of h of minus n minus 1 minus n, that which shows anti-symmetry with respect to alpha is equal to n minus 1 by 2. You can simply substitute h of n with these values and alpha with n minus 1 by 2 in order to check whether this particular equation is equal to 0 or not. Therefore, FIR filters can have constant group delay and not constant phase delay whenever the impulse response is anti-symmetrical about this alpha is equal to n minus 1 by 2. From the above equations, now I would like to just show you this center of symmetry, which actually shows some kind of anti-symmetry here. whenever we consider n is equal to 7, the impulse response satisfying the above conditions for is shown in this figure, where the for n is equal to 7 as well as n is equal to 6, with even indexed samples as well as odd samples. For odd sequences, we find that h of n minus 1 by 2 is equal to 0. H of n minus 1 by 2 is equal to 0 at something like n is equal to 3 here in this case, when n is 7. And we are able to see that it is anti-symmetric with respect to the center of symmetry. Similarly, in the case of n is equal to 6, we also see that here the center of symmetry lies at 2.5 samples. And however, it is also representing some anti-symmetry with respect to alpha is equal to n minus 1 by 2. And to summarize, the conditions for the constant group and phase delay are: the impulse response is symmetrical about alpha is equal to n minus 1 by 2, and we will be able to see a constant group delay whenever the impulse response is anti-symmetrical about alpha is equal to n minus 1 by 2. That's it for this lecture. So we will continue with this some more characteristics as well as the design procedures of FIR filter design in the next lecture. Thank you.